By now, most of you are familiar with the video of Father James Altman, in which he states that Pope Francis is not the legitimate pope. As many of you know, Father Altman is a priest for the Diocese of La Crosse in Wisconsin. In 2020, Father Altman put forward a series of statements against Joe Biden and certain leftist organizations, such as Black Lives Matter.
Here's a memo to clueless baptized Catholics out there. You cannot be Catholic and be a Democrat, period. Their party platform absolutely is against everything the Catholic Church teaches. So just quit pretending that you're Catholic and vote Democrat. Repent of your support of that party and its platform or face the fires of hell. Yes, Virginia, there is a hell. There's a well-known cleric who seems to be putting out there that, oh, hell is an empty place. Sorry, buddy, it's not what Jesus said. Jesus said many are gonna choose that broad road to destruction. Only a few are gonna choose the narrow, very difficult road to the narrow gate to heaven. There will be 60 million and counting aborted babies standing at the gates of heaven barring your Democrat entrance, and nothing you can say will ever excuse you for your direct or indirect support of that diabolical agenda here in the end.
Some people interpreted these statements as overly harsh and polemical, and Altman was therefore asked by his bishop to go on administrative leave. Some sources even claim who have been in contact with diocesan officials in the Diocese of La Crosse and claim that Father Altman has been laicized. But there is some controversy or debate on this point. In fact, neither Father Altman nor the Diocese of La Crosse, at the time in which this video was made, have either affirmed or denied this claim. Since stepping down from his official pastoral and ecclesiastical duties, Father Altman has continued to be very outspoken on various controversies within the church and the wider society, including being very critical of certain actions and teachings on the part of Pope Francis. On September 8, 2023, a YouTube channel connected with Father Altman released a video of a short speech by Father in which he claimed that, due to the various forms of corruption and supposedly heretical teachings of Pope Francis, Pope Francis is not a validly elected pope. Now, like with most people, Father Altman says things that I agree with, and he says some things that I disagree with. This video in particular, I see as being intellectually lazy, in a sense. Father Altman accepts the position of Saint Robert Bellarmine, who states that a pope ceases to be pope immediately upon becoming a heretic. The church has never formally or dogmatically affirmed that position, but it does appear, at least in my research, to be one of the more widespread positions among theologians and canonists, and, for me, seems to make the most sense. Yet, Father Altman cites a series of examples of heretical teachings and corrupt actions from Pope Francis that supposedly prove that Pope Francis is not a valid pope. That is a wrong-headed approach to the issue of whether or not a particular pope is a validly elected pope. Because technically, in Bellarmine's view, you have to keep in mind two things. One, there is only one specific event that causes you to cease to be a pope. If a pope does multiple things that would cause him to lose the papacy, unless they are all committed simultaneously, the pope only ceases to be a valid pope once he commits the first of these sins or crimes. Second of all, not every form of corruption is sufficient to bring about excommunication or the loss of papal office. And further, not every excommunicable offense brings about automatic excommunication, and therefore does not bring about an automatic loss of the papal office. That is why, in debates concerning whether or not a pope can ever lose his papal authority, or under what circumstances a pope can lose his papal authority, there's a lot of emphasis on the case of heresy. Heresy is one of those sins that brings about automatic excommunication. That is, you are excommunicated the moment you choose to willingly accept a heresy. And you're considered excommunicated even prior to any decree from the church. Thus, Father Altman's argument for why Pope Francis is not a valid pope is not, theologically or canonically, the most sophisticated. Its main premise is, if I list a series of bad or controversial things that Pope Francis has said or done, maybe people will agree that he is not the pope. Yet, what I would like to focus in on here is not the contents of his argument, but rather a controversy that developed in the immediate aftermath of Father Altman putting forward these statements on Pope Francis. On September 15th, 2023, the website of Corpus Christi for Unity and Peace, a Catholic activist organization, published an article in which it put forward its official statement on Father Altman's recent words. In an interview with Father Altman, they asked him if he was a sedevacantist, and he answered in the negative. According to Altman, sedevacantism refers primarily to that ideology found among the fringes of the traditionalist movement that claims that Vatican II was heretical and that none of the popes who came to power during or after Vatican II were validly elected, primarily on account of their acceptance of Vatican II. The thing is, technically speaking, anyone who denies that the current pope is validly elected is a sedevacantist. As an organized movement, sedevacantism developed in the immediate aftermath of the Second Vatican Council among the more extreme proponents of the reactionary movement in the church, and they were, more specifically, responding to, or to be more precise, responding against the Second Vatican Council. Whereas Father Altman is not rejecting the larger theological worldview or the reforms brought about by Vatican II, but is responding to the bad words and actions of a specific pope. Thus, technically, anyone who rejects the fact that the pope is truly the pope is a sedevacantist. Yet, Father Altman is limiting the definition of sedevacantism to a specific movement, a movement found among really only certain members of the church, that is to say, certain radical traditionalist or ultra-conservative Catholics, whose ideas emerged within a very specific historical period and ideological context. And this showcases something important, namely, that people don't judge ideologies based on the content of their belief alone, but rather on how the movement or members associated with that ideology relate to the rest of society, or to the rest of a specific group. The implications, the baggage, or the larger historical context of an ideology are, in the popular imagination, just as influential in determining what constitutes a specific ideology, or a quote-unquote true supporter of that ideology, as the strict dictionary definition of an ideology. I mean, think about it. Father Altman, prior to this past autumn, would have been viewed as a standard, run-of-the-mill, moderate or conservative Catholic. Someone like Patrick Coffin, for example, would have been viewed as being as close to true ideological center as was possible. Nobody would have ever associated these individuals with what historically, 40 or 50 years ago, would have been labeled sedevacantist. Yet, technically, that's what they are. My main point is this. People, in a word, want their ideological stances to be judged not solely or primarily on a strict interpretation or definition of their ideology, which is based on an understanding of the contents of their belief, but by something broader that they claim to stand for. Every time a person takes an ideological stance, it isn't born merely out of being convinced of a specific proposition or set of propositions, though that is part of it. Rather, there is a broader, underlying logic that is usually being supported, though not always explicitly articulated. But it is this underlying logic that is the main motivating factor behind everything they say or do. It is a reaction against some way things were in the past, or dissatisfaction with the way things are now. It is a belief that things could or should be a certain way, and that this is preferable to the way things are or were. They see certain things as being emotionally or morally at stake in the accepting or rejecting of a specific ideological position. Father Altman has a specific vision of what Catholicism is or should be, one defined by the more moderate or conservative interpretations of Vatican II that emerged under the pontificates of Pope St. John Paul II and Pope Benedict XVI. It is one that avoids the extremes of radical traditionalism as well as radical liberalism. For Father Altman, everything that is wrong with the church is personified by the sedevacantists on the one hand and Pope Francis on the other. It is for this reason that Father Altman can literally endorse the sedevacantist position while also claiming not to be a sedevacantist. Here, Father Altman is not defining sedevacantism based on an understanding of the contents of the sedevacantist position, but rather based on the broader vision of what Catholicism is or should be. Father Altman rejects the notion that Catholic theology stopped developing at the time of the Council, and that anything that took place during or after the Council is to be rejected. Because he rejects that theological vision, he wants to distance himself from the sedevacantists. And in some sense, the opposite is also true. Most sedevacantists, in the historical sense of the word sedevacantist, would consider Father Altman to be a heretic, and not even a validly ordained priest, precisely because he accepts Vatican II. The larger point to keep in mind is that underlying ideological trends is the question, what do I as an individual, or what do we as a community stand for? And sometimes this question of what do we stand for has a meaning much broader or much vaguer than the question, what are the contents of my beliefs? Since, at least subconsciously or on a practical level, the former has implications that go far beyond the latter. Part of what defines this notion of what we stand for is how we relate to others and their ideologies or worldviews. Father Altman represents a very specific brand of Catholicism. He represents the more conservative strain of the theological worldview or interpretation of Catholicism that emerged during and after Vatican II. Yet such a worldview has always been in competition with the radical liberals who rose to prominence immediately before, during, and after the Council, who were seen as desiring reform for reform's sake, who were seen as going beyond the acceptable bounds of reform in the church by bringing about certain reforms or bringing about reform in a specific manner or extent that struck at the very roots of our Catholic identity. Hence, Father Altman must distance himself from Pope Francis, who he sees as being aligned with, or as being the very embodiment, of the radical liberalism of the 1960s and 1970s. Yet he also sees no conflict between Vatican II and the larger historical teachings of the Church. He therefore takes no issue with what was said by most of the popes between Pope St. John XXIII and Pope Benedict XVI. Father Altman can therefore be described as anything ranging from a moderate traditionalist or a neo-traditionalist to what some have called a novus ordo conservative. He thus must distance himself from the more radical extremes of traditionalism. Thus, Father Altman rejects the title of sedevacantist, not because that's an inaccurate label, but because he doesn't like the historical or sociological or ideological baggage that that phrase has, or what it means in the popular imagination. My response is, let's be honest with ourselves. The way we categorize ideologies is determined partly by the contents of that belief system, and partly by how the belief system relates to other belief systems and the historical context that produced it. Yet, and I'm not saying this to either condemn or exonerate Pope Francis, but no one can deny that, love him or hate him, he has been a somewhat controversial pope. And the Church, in the past roughly decade since his election, has gone in a direction that most people couldn't have ever expected it going in, even within the past few decades. When someone like, again, Patrick Coffin becomes more radical than someone like Michael Voris, yeah, remember that time when Michael Voris was considered one of the most hardline traditionalists in the mainstream church? Do you know that if Patrick Coffin is seen as more extreme than someone like the SSPX or even a Michael Voris, that the church is in a strange new situation? We thus need to be honest in terms of the historical context that produces our ideologies, as well as the personal things that produced such an ideology. That is, what we personally see as being morally at stake in an ideology, or personal, spiritual, or emotional things that move us to support or reject an ideology. And when we do that, we can, firstly, be more honest about the nature of our ideology, and secondly, be more precise in terms of the taxonomy of ideologies.